Greetings in the name of the most, the ultimate. Okay, well, here we are once again, and I realize that I need to be a bit more efficient. We had a 3-hour pod yesterday that couldn't be released because I guess I've wandered into away from the actual thing, and it became show prep, though. Nothing wasted here. God bless you, each and every one of you. Zeph Daniel here, the Zeph Report. I've been notified that Brother Thomas has been ill with migraines. So I want you all to stop right now and pray. In Jesus' name, I pray this. And I'm very serious about this. Lord, I cast out that migraine and all the spirits and all the things surrounding that migraine in Brother Thomas and your beloved son, Lord. I cast it out, and I ask you all to join me in casting it out and casting this affliction out and to the pit where it belongs in Jesus' name. Furthermore, there will be no evidence of migraines. There will be no need for CAT scans and the rest of it. It just must go away, Lord, in Jesus' name. We just can't have it. Let it be a testimony of a miracle. Let it be now. Let the healing be now, and let you all join in this prayer, and however you do it is fine. For Brother Thomas's migraine condition, because it's always a spiritual condition, and these sicknesses are always spirits. He's afflicted because of the work that he does, not the labor intensive work, but the work he does for the Lord brings blowback. And so I want you to keep him in prayer, but I want you to pray a prayer of protection in Jesus' name right now. For all the workers of the Lord, you know, we don't have the backing of any church or organization or the world, none. We're stripped naked, put out there in ones and twos to bring something of the Lord to those who have ears. I can tell this is developing into something. So I will continue pacing. We just enjoyed a rain with the moon still pretty full going in and out of the clouds. I found myself in the middle of the night. Oh, I feel it's done. Yes, I feel that Brother Thomas is in good stead with the Lord. I understand that we are given afflictions from time to time, that cause us to doubt or to re-examine the things of the Lord and what the Lord does and who he is, and questions like, Lord, why would you put us here in this hellish situation that we find ourselves in on earth with the political climate as it is and all kinds of threats of civil wars and unrest and bankrupt, you know, into a complete fear-oriented thing when the beautiful earth and the beautiful creation of you, Lord, testifies of your awesome power and majesty, my God. Your children are asking, why them? What about those who abused them? What about those who abuse those very few in the positions of power, those very, very few, imposing their will on billions to degrade them, to dehumanize them, Lord? So I further pray that this is stopped. Lord has, what I got this night is that the Lord has intervened and interceded with the evil ones who wouldn't even be able to be a, you know, a dog catcher in our, the real world. And the Lord knows this, and this is the subject of the word that I started breaking out yesterday, but I'm going to break it out today. And this is, if I do it right, then you will understand a lot of things. If I don't, then it will be like yesterday, show prep, and you'll never hear it. Because your ears are, at the Zeph Report, they're shielded from things that you shouldn't hear when I divulge too much. You know, sometimes I go into anecdotes and things, and sometimes I go, I'm treading on territory that I probably shouldn't be on. Not that I won't be, but it's the timing of a thing. Anyway, this word deals with, all right, part two. Yeah, with this recorder, this exquisite recorder that I need to use for my ambient sound. It's all about sound. And yeah, poor man's interview. You put the mic of this thing up, and then you have four inputs. I put another mic, a studio mic on me, put this thing up to a cell phone in speaker mode, and you got yourself an interview. It's just that simple. I'm amazed. My life has been more simple, but okay. So here it is. It's 2 Peter 2:9, as I talked about yesterday on the Z and Frankie and Trish show. And here it is, 2 Peter 2:9. And I promised you that I would do this, right? And we've done 3 hours of show prep, plus brought it out a little bit on the Z and Frankie. And this is a verse the Lord gave me. And then let's see where it goes. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Now, I know you're probably thinking that's unbelievable, especially in the context of what was just said here. Yes, the Lord knows how to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Notice, so when you're looking for karmic rebuke, you have to realize, here is proof. And I believe this verse came directly from, this is directly the word of God. You are hearing the word of God. I didn't let it go, Lord. I know he gave me this verse. He knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations. In other words, to steer you out of these temptations, to keep you out of the world system, which he's done with me every time they're about to try to, you know, jimmy me in there. Something got distracted, something happened, and I, you know, went off another way. There was an intervention, and I call it angelic intervention. And, you know, and the temptations of the world are, you know, obvious, you know. So, and I'm just a human. I can be tempted. So the Lord has had to intervene to keep my way straight. Otherwise, I would have gone astray. But it was not of my doing. I know my old friends just think I'm a fanatic, and they don't really realize that I've been honed, I've been shaped, you know, by the Lord, who has kept me out of temptation and kept the evil away from me. In other words, they say, well, your time of death is when we say, and the Lord says, I will confound them with your highly energized life, even more energy now than before. So, you know, and when they're thwarted like that, sometimes they repent, but usually they just get very angry. All right, let's continue. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Okay. So you see the unjust, in my view, that the Lord is speaking of, because we really do speak of things like, you know, the powers that be, the unjust, you know, they're in positions of power where they could mete out injustice rather than justice. These are the people that should be, and it also includes others, but I mean, this the context of this, it does deal with the government. And you'll see how it breaks down. Now, watch. For that righteous man dwelling among them and seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. So now we're talking about the unlawful, people that are unlawful toward government and God. And so you're going to see how this ties in. But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. And despise law is a better word. Presumptuous are they, self-willed. They are not afraid to speak evil of dignities. And here we have evil of dignities, the phrase found in the book of Jude. And here comes another doppelganger. Whereas angels, which are greater in power and might, bring not a railing accusation against them before the Lord. This refers to in the book of Jude, which we will go to. In fact, we should just go there now and then come back. In the book of Jude, I pray, Lord, I stay nice and focused here. In the book of Jude, we only have one chapter, so here we go. Okay. In the book of Jude, we're talking about lawless ones. And they say, likewise also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. There you go again. Speak evil of dignities. Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring him against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. And now, back to 2 Peter 2, 9. Okay. Whereas angels, which are greater in power, this is 2 Peter 2, 11, whereas angels, which are greater in power and might, bring not railing accusation against them before the Lord. But these as natural brute beasts made to be taken and destroyed speak evil of things they understand not and shall utterly perish in their own corruption and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness as they count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. Spots are they and blemishes sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. Now, dignities. Also means dignitaries. These refer to angelic hosts. These chapters are directed also toward Gnostics who crept in unaware, who become lawless because they feel like, in other words, they are saved by Jesus under grace. Man's laws no longer have any power. So there were scriptures, and I agree this is edited, and I just proved to you that there was editing, you know, of these people later after, you know, in other words, some of this is imposed upon the scripture, but you see, watch how the Lord uses this to put the focus on governmental control of people. This is where, you know, and then we're going to tie in Romans 13, and we're going to tie in the golden calf as well. The lawless, in other words, the Gnostics are kind of like the worshippers of the golden calf, and which were tempted by Satan to do whatever they wanted, even though they were under the authority of Moses, hence of God. They rebelled against, you know, the government, the powers that were in, you know, that they were following, that they agreed to be led by. And so they became lawless with Moses and lawless with God until Moses had to eliminate them from the body of Moses, the body at that time that were in the wilderness, because God could not bless that body because all would perish unless, you know, justice was meted out. It had to be meted out right then, because that kind of lawlessness would take down the whole situation of Moses. And, you know, but notice that as soon as they break God's laws, that they speak evil of dignities, Moses, the angels, his relationship with God, all of it, hence God. They, when they throw the laws out, they stop obeying the laws of Moses. In other words, the order of the day, which is to be reverent toward God and not build a golden calf, obviously. And not, and of course, the same old thing they do is they go wildly out of control with their orgies and adulteries and their lies, similar to what you see today. You know, the do what thou wilt crowd. And they follow no law. And they speak evil of dignities. And they are lusting after their own flesh, lusting to have any kind of perverted, you know, thing they can finally get into. That would include, you know, that also includes your, you know, your Satanists, your human sacrifice. A lot of people that are in positions of power who are beholden to that golden calf today. Okay, so these were the lawless ones who then infiltrated and took over positions of power. But you were not to bring a railing accusation against them, you see. And it's repeated, and that's fine that it's repeated word for word, which of course should be red flags in all camps, and isn't, and hasn't been, ever. Which is, of course, typical. And so they say, well, you know, they speak evil of, they hate government. No, you see, the word there is better, laws. Man's laws, God's laws, dignities, the leaders of the day, the angels, the prophets, the word, etc. And some of these got inspired by, when they're saved by grace, they're free of the law, free of man's laws, and they're free of the law, and they can do whatever they want. This was a problem with the Gnostics. So if they wanted to engage back in the pagan ways because they lusted after the flesh, they would do so, even to the point of casting out their own dignitaries, like, say, St. Paul the Apostle, casting him out even, you know, from his own church that he founded, which in the book of Jude says that, you know, the churches have been infiltrated. In the book of Revelation, Jesus lays it out what had happened to the churches of Asia, and we are a derivation today of the churches of Asia. So total apostasy has hit the land of the United States, both in government, in churches, in institutions in general, in Western civilization. And so what is the Lord saying here? And I, you know, I offer you my two cents in this, which is basically this. The Lord is basically showing you how he does not wish to be cut out of the equation. And so when we have these problems, we've already been told that God knows how to deliver people, of the righteous people amongst the unrighteous and unlawful. And so these people that are the dignities are the, are, you know, Paul goes so far as to say, or whoever wrote this, so far as to say, the rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. In other words, they uphold laws that prevent people from just going on mass killings and, you know, mass just doing whatever they want, lawlessness in society. So he says these people are good and government is good. That people who do evil should be afraid, because the ministers of justice, the government will prosecute those people and all that. And so in Romans 13, you know, it's basically not just that, but the reason that emphasis is there, which is heavily edited, obviously, but the reason that emphasis is there is to say that the government comes from God, as all things do. God has his hand in everything. And this is what the true spirit of Romans 13 is. Don't just bring railing accusations about, you know, the government or dignities, where whatever they may be. Because we're subject to the laws and the lawmakers, and the we're subject to that to a certain extent. So we have to be respectful of that structure, that God has his hand there. Not take it into our own hands like so many in the so-called patriot community have already blown it with God because they've already violated his word. In taking the law into their own hands, they have become lawless. Because you see, we are, and then the rest of Romans 13, it's not fair what people say about it. It goes into adultery and the various sins in addition to despise of governance, which is despise of laws. We are to be blameless, as Jesus taught us, in the midst of their Roman world, which was equally as corrupt as this. And yet here is Paul saying these things, or whoever, because I do believe there's editing involved, but I think there is something there that has been enhanced probably to mean that, you know, the government officials are all from God, so obey them. Okay. And rather, that's not the spirit of truth. So the spirit of truth, when you look deeper into it, it means God has his hand in all governments and all the kingdoms of the world. Please go to him for redress because, as it says in 2 Peter 2:9, the Lord knows how to hold these people, the wicked, and knows their day comes at his choosing. Do not bring railing accusations against them because the Lord already has this. In fact, the Lord wants to be cut into your grief. You're being vexed, as it says, the righteous are vexed. Righteousness just simply means with God. It doesn't mean you're perfect. It just means you're questing for God. Your life is wrapped around God. You belong on the side of God. That's the side you're on. So you'd be counted as righteous. The side, people on the world side would be considered unrighteous because they are serving the opposite of that which is good. You know, in other words, they serve themselves, like so many in the government today, which is admittedly out of control. And they serve themselves, and they believe the people are there to serve them, not them serve the people. And it's the most uncanny, horrifying thing to see this in America, to see this tremendous failure on all levels of the country, and with the people who are making it fail, celebrating with each passing failure. Well, I'm going to teach you now how you can get through this in one piece without grieving every day, because the way it is now, you could cry every day, but it's not going to do you any good. It's just going to sap your energy. So when we understand that the Lord has this, we understand that the Lord is the one who has his hand in all things upon the earth, and his will be done always, ultimately. I think what we have, what happens when, you know, people that are of God vacate their first love and become lawless, yet they're still the leaders. Are they from God? Do we lead them? What the Lord is saying here in these verses, especially Romans 13, Peter 2, 9, Jude, and so forth, is that God knows how to deal with these people. In fact, already has it laid out what he is going to do, how he is going to deal with it. And notice as we go to Revelation 18, the Lord says, "Celebrate, for I have finally avenged the evil from the beginning of time." Furthermore, well, I know you ask, why are these people allowed to run around and do what they do? Well, there's a number of reasons for that, because the earth must go into this time of man, has to become the time of the worst iniquity of all time for God to bring about the solution to his finale. And so we have to have maximum darkness, almost like the curtain is down and it's dark in the theater. And then when it goes up, we have the revelation of the Lord. We have the light so blinding, so bright that we can't look at it, because it can only be manifested in full glory in a darkened situation. If everything is light, then of course light would make no difference. That is, in my view, the Lord has laid out a story how man would become more and more wicked through time. He would do what he wants to do, which we've seen the from the left and from the right, but from the left mainly, this sort of inculcation of do what thou wilt regarding everything. So disobey the Bible, disobey the dignities the very people in power today are lawless, and they're the ones who crept in unawares. And the Lord is simply saying, yes, the Lord still has his hand on the government, even though they're so evil and so terrible. We are not to bring railing accusations against them, because you see, Michael the archangel said, the Lord rebuke thee when dealing with Satan. You know, it was not I, Michael, rebuke. You know, I'm not yelling at the devil or yelling at his people. I am handing the situation over to the Lord and saying, Lord, please guide me on how to deal with this situation. And the Lord comes back to me and says, Zeph, you know, you must be exemplary. And, you know, to the pure, all things are pure. And so, see, to the pure, you are living this life to be exemplary in following laws, being a good citizen, being, you know, so that if and when anything comes down of an evil or unjust nature, it becomes very, very difficult, becomes very convicting. When people who have done not a thing wrong, and who in fact are blameless, are then targeted, and in being blameless and being lawful, you see, we bring an example. It actually spreads the gospel and the word of God 10 times further than if you were just deciding to go lawless because you don't like what they're doing and they're evil, so you decide you're going to go do something about it. Or scream about it, or bring railing accusations against them all. And we do this. I, for one, have done a lot of it, probably more than you. And I tell you that I received this word because I understand now, finally, at long last, how the Lord wants us to be in him. And not, you know, basically, what these verses, and especially Romans 13, what they're saying is, do not cut the Lord out of the deal. But rather go to Jude, you know, seek the Father and understand that 2 Peter 2:9 that he is saying, I know how to reserve judgment for these people at the time of my choosing or at the time of judgment. I will mete out justice. Nobody gets away with anything. The wicked will be held to account, and you will be. Those of you who have been offended, or you've been hurt, or you've been abused, your day will come where you can let all this go. In fact, the Lord wants you to let it go even right now, because you've handed it to him, knowing that your Father will take care of you and take care of these issues. When the government, like the time of Caesar, goes completely corrupt, Jesus still says, but God must be your focus. Whether the government's good or evil, it shouldn't matter. These are earthly governments. These are earthly things. These don't have anything really to do with you. You should just give to Caesar what Caesar has been, give to God what is God's, meaning whatever you're subject to, some are born slaves. To your master, obey, but do so because the Lord is your God and you are free. And you will do that job no matter how detestable you thought it was, because you're doing it in the sight of the Lord. Those of you who are American citizens, obviously you've been enslaved here. And, you know, there is a captivity right here in your own land. And you know, you're being replaced and you're being vilified. And they're ramping up all their military and domestic operations. I told you a long time ago, I said, when you're dealing with the left, you're dealing with an intolerant totalitarian regime that would love to occupy the land and round up people that think differently than them. And they're totally fascistic and totally intolerant of everything. Okay, we know that. But we must take it to the Lord and say, okay, what do we do? And it's like, you expose truth, son. And when they are found to be lawless, when they're found to be evil and all that, it certainly expose it. But then you must say, and you must take this other step of, instead of being personally offended and having it ruin your day, you must say, the Lord has got this. The Lord rebuke thee. Notice how Michael didn't say, well, I'm going to keep my mouth shut, and he's not going to say anything to the devil. No, he says, the Lord rebuke thee. He says something. And I say to them, the Lord has your day, because I have faith, because my faith is increased. I know that the Lord will mete out justice at his timing. I don't need to be particular of when that timing is, because I'm just, you know, I'm not the potter, I'm the clay. So I will not question the Lord. I just know that he will deal with whatever you think is wrong. And many of you have been, downsized, thrown out of work. You know, you're shuffling along at this very, very difficult time of deintegration and the downfall of, you know, a structure that you had. And the only way that you're going to get through it is to have the ultimate structure of the Lord God, Jesus Christ, God Almighty. Because that's the only way that you have a framework for your life. And so even with these grievances that you have, and I know people are posting all about, Obama and what he's done, and we had the rainbow flag incident, which is, now become a symbol of fascism, which is, I knew it would ultimately, and that idea will spread more and more far and wide. And that is almost like a way of the, let me explain what the Lord is doing today. He said, well, he's not going to do anything until the day of judgment. Wrong. He's already moved things around so that certain results that people are keep prophesying about, quote, quote, don't happen because of the fact that he moves things around. He hears your prayers and he's responded, but his response is subtle and many can't catch it. I can, so let me tell you what he's done. What he's done is, I think I told you this, but perhaps your faith was too weak to receive it. Let's see if today you can receive it. He takes their minds, groups, globally, whatever, and he just moves them off of a thing like, say, a nuclear war. He's done this about 6 times since we spoke about it with Syria and remember the chemical weapons and all that and the blaming of Assad. And, that's still going. They're still, working on getting him, and, McCain and Obama have their ISIS. Yes, expose it. ISIS is being run on it. I know that the rest are going to join me pretty soon in recognizing that ISIS is run on a daily basis by our people. And I not setting them up and letting them go. We don't do that. There's too much money involved. We know that, but we the information warriors and all that, they will catch up with that eventually. They're just looking for corroboration, and they shall have it. I can't tell you when, because my opinion is at this point, you could say it's a spiritual guess, prophetic guess, some kind of intuition, whatever, to be confirmed by that. You don't pay me to go look at news and bring it to you. You want my intuition. You want the gifts God gave me to be used in this regard. It doesn't surprise me, because most of everything that has to do with war deals with a club that brings war, and they're internationalist, and there's just a few of them, and they put millions and millions of people in harm's way, and get away with it because you are blind here. You cannot identify who they are. And so I think probably people now are tired of war here in the United States. And so they go, okay, we'll just put the military on you then. You're the bad guy. And they never stop. They're in the war. They are there to bring conflict between people. They are not peacemakers, okay? They are. They also feel that all the land of the United States, especially California, is the next thing where they're going to move people. They're going to start moving people out of California, and going along with the agenda because they feel the land, we're squatting on their land. That's why they have all these troops and all this stuff, to kind of remind you that you're either going to be a good, dutiful slave or you're not going to be here. So times are rough. We all studied German history and, history of Europe and the Nazis and the evil. We thought, how could people do those kind of things? Well, here it is, your very own people that you elect who take a big crap on you and put you in the crosshairs of losing everything, your freedom, anything that you had. So what you have to do is, obviously, with the relationship with the Lord, you have already inherited all things. You must really be strong in your faith. We talked about this in a prior podcast about how through faith, everything happens. I told you there will be an increase in faith. A in some cases, a thousandfold increase. In some cases, powers that you wouldn't think humans would have, but they don't know they have them unless they have faith. So it's the most bizarre thing. And then if you really have faith, you do all things unto the Lord because you have faith. Therefore, the powers that come through you or that you have about you, like this power of healing, is at your command in a sense. But without faith, no. Without faith, you would pray things that may not happen. I'm not in the business of praying for something that won't happen. Prayer is an awesome responsibility, as I said, because whatever I put my focus on and pray, something will happen. I have to pray the Lord's will. I don't want to go off and I don't even know what my will would be. But in terms of the American government, the way it is, and the thing that vexes the people still haven't woken up. I'm talking about the people that are consider themselves awake, still haven't woken up to understand what they're looking at here. They think it's, the government. And there's so much focus by these Christians on the government as to violate God's word in total. And your present company included, unfortunately. But, I'm just human too, like you. And, I want to get to the bottom of it. The bottom of it, again, unless you factor in the whole multidimensional, rulers over this in high places that you can't see, unless you factor that aspect into it, you'll think it's just like you're the human government. That's not who's running the show. Most of those guys don't even know why they do what they do. They just know that if they don't do it, they'll be in trouble, whatever it is. Now, I pray, O Lord, for this problem of rampant corruption in our leaders. I hand it to you, Lord, because your hand is on it completely. Thank you, Father, for steering us out of disaster time and time again. I'm sad that your people haven't noticed your workings, Lord, but I have noticed them. And I'm telling them about it today. They have been miracles, every one of them, and huge and worth reporting about. But people are distracted. You see, you're distracted away from the Lord. You're distracted away from the power of God. You're distracted away from the power of prayer. You're distracted through fear and feeling sorry for yourselves, just barely limping through the day, which is no testimony at all. Hey, I wouldn't know it if I didn't do it myself. Okay? It's not like I'm, sitting here perfect and you're the one that's screwing up. No, I think we all have had a hand in a lot of this stuff. And Frankie and I have talked about it, about the end of the world. How many dates have we gone through now? And I think what people have to understand is questions like that are meaningless. Just like bringing railing accusations against, say, Obama, for example, who, by the way, will surprise a lot of people. In fact, he's not the same person you saw before. He's pretty well hated around the world, almost like a conservative. and people don't appreciate, him in Kenya going and lecturing the people on how they should be and rebuking them for how they're not. And he's just become his own pompous ass. He's not in the holy place, though, declaring himself the... I mean, there are people torturing the scriptures and torturing themselves, trying to make Obama the AC. And then there's another competing wing that the Pope has actually been in the so-called holy place, declaring himself God. And so you have, you're speaking great blasphemies of both of them against the Most High in their political rhetoric. And, I just call it the rise of Antichrist. Without putting a specific person in the driver's seat, it's just we're seeing it kind of across the board. So let's talk about it in those terms. We're seeing the beast, the Antichrist, the false prophet, all of it at once. So I don't think it's that particular. I know that the Catholic exorcists did an exorcism on a town via helicopter. They had to fly over the town to actually do an exorcism. These people know what they're doing. They know more about demonology and more about the whole workings of it, which is still hidden from our people. It's not taught in classes. It's not taught. The Protestant deliverance ministries that we've seen and the books we've seen about demonology don't seem to really get the full comprehensive view as the Vatican exorcist and the Vatican has. And so you see, God is using them now via helicopter, a whole town. Obviously, this is huge news, because there hasn't been exorcisms on a mass scale like this that I can think of. But when you think of the Catholic Church, just like anything else, just like you think of the Jews, okay, it's a mixed bag. You have the righteous in there doing good works and not getting any credit. And then the broad brushing, the railing accusations, oh, it's all bad. It's the Vatican. They belong to the devil. Catholics belong to Satan. That's bull. All the Jews are bad. The Jews caused all the bull. See, the real mystery is you don't know who's causing it at all. You run down one thread, you run down another. Well, Dick Cheney's a genius. No, Dick Cheney is a mass murderer on 9/11. Well, but you bring that accusation, but, you know, they've, so far, it hasn't stuck. The only thing I could do is take that to the Lord and say, Lord, well, there, if there is definitive proof, it certainly has not been aired. So if I bring a railing accusation against him, a leader, and say, he pulled the trigger, and he moved the planes around, and he did it all. Even though the funny thing about it all is, that about all this, and about, you know, the whole 9/11 thing, the 9/11 thing is, as I said before, is the proof about 9/11 is 9/11 itself. That's all you need to, that's all I ever needed to know. I don't know what, why people argue about things when, you know, it's almost like they put a, you know, they get a pizza and they put it on the table and you go, that's a pizza. They go, you conspiracy theory. No, it's a, you know, a pizza. I'm sorry. But you see, people have gotten so crazy. And you have to understand, the consciousness is out of control. The consciousness, the mind of the collective hive leadership is completely insane. You're starting to realize that. And thanks to that insanity, just like Saul of old, they can't function as a unit. Plus, they hate each other and they hate themselves. They cannot govern because a house divided cannot stand. They blame the people and want to ramp up against the people, but it's them who cannot govern. It's them who failed. And so, as usual, when you have losers like these people, what they do is they blame the other guy. In other words, we can't govern. It's the American people's fault. We need to attack them. This didn't work. Well, it's the Chinese. We got to get, right? So it's never them. It will never be them. And that's pathetic. A good leader would recognize his own, you know, faults and own up to them and try to correct them and not, you know, have to be perfect. These people do, and they're very impetuous, understood, and they're as children in adult jobs. Oh, totally understood. Enfant terrible is all, you know, in jobs that are meant that wisdom and leadership skills are needed, and there are none. Right. Well, this is all part of a judgment against the people. I can just put it into context now. The Lord has the government. The Lord has the governments of the world. The Lord has the populations of the world, and he is saying in a loud, clear voice, come to me with all of your humanity, with all your hate and with all your love and with everything that is you. Come to me now and lay it down. I've got this. Don't cut me out of the deal and focus only on politics or whatever. That's a way to make yourselves miserable. Quit talking about end times prophecy like, you know, here we come into September, just a month away, and already we're saying that's the end again. We're saying there'll be a false flag attack to bring in martial law on a certain date. That's why they're doing the practicing. That's why there's all the FEMA camps. That's where there's all the grave. That's why they have the guillotines will be rolled out, and it's going to be Katie bar the door. Well, yeah, they'll roll the guillotines out if the Bible says there's going to be guillotines. There are people that want to fulfill those prophecy. So that makes sense. But still, okay, so that means God's word is accurate, right? That The people so far have not gone beyond how they were characterized in the Bible prophetically. They're behaving exactly the way the Bible said they would behave. Are they not? And the kinds of things you see that are so horrifying, you've already been prepped for in your Bibles. They've already told you that the time of tribulation will be a time more terrible than any time in history. And the people going through this ordeal, you know, may not make it out alive in terms of your bodies. But your soul, well, the Lord will take you. It's just that, you know, even more to the point, we have to have our eyes on the Lord at all times. Every day, every night, 24/7, because of this tough time, the only way you're going to have the strength to meet it is to get through it in that manner. Faith is the thing that will make the difference in your life. Now, you know, I recognize that in my own life, in my own, you know, businesses and different things, I have no control over what they're going to do or not do, or what people are going to do, or what the economy is going to do. Everyone tells me that, Zeph, you should have gone off to an island somewhere. You're still in the United States, and you had a chance to get out. It's your fault. It's like, brother, if I lose my life, I'm okay with it. You don't understand. I'm here because the Lord has put me here. If he says to go run away, then I will run away, but I'm not going to run away, even if it's a dangerous situation that the Lord has put me here. If the Lord says, go run away to escape pain and suffering at leaving my fellow friends and associates and whatnot to bear the brunt while I, what, enjoy myself somewhere? I don't think there, you know, the enjoyment I get, I feel like I go through my routine. I'm going in the studio in just a few minutes here because I have faith. I'm about to release a track by Kelly and I that I produced it. Kelly sung, brought lyrics to it, performed it, and, you know, pretty much, you know, brought the melody and, you know, and I had a backing track. I had a rhythm section, a nice rhythm section. These were stems I had that I mixed, and I found these stems. I was like, wow, these sounds like a pretty good recording here. You know, and so I started arranging and rearranging and trying to arrange it into, you know, into my own thing, you know. And we had a good start there. But again, you know, she's like an instrument bringing the melody, and then all of a sudden that, you know, that sort of made it. So this is called Heist. And it's got a lot of imagery of robbing banks and different things, but really, what Heist is, you know, I think what we're talking about, I mean, I'm not sure. I have to read her rewrite of my lyrics, which are really new lyrics on her part. But really, I think what it is, you know, grabbing the world with all the gusto, you know, take the big bite out of the apple, and then, you know, making something of yourselves out there, but then living now in regret. Very similar to when I talked about this before my father's funeral and the people there that, my brother and I used to be, we remember when my parents were young, before they were 40. And here we were living, you know, with them, and their friends would come over and they'd yell and they'd cheer on. The men would be cheering on the football team or whatever it was. They'd have that on their little TV or their radio or something, and they'd be listening and cheering, and the women would be kind of gossiping. Then they're all going to go out to dinner and dancing and do whatever they're going to do, living the good life. And then to see what has happened to them by the time of my father's funeral was a real eye-opener, in a sense, for me, to see how they had, you know, several of them had gone broke and were in ill health and were just, you know, very, very sad. They didn't know, have much to say. They looked at me and they said, well, I'm sorry that we're not meeting under better circumstances. I think, you know, and I realized that there's nothing I could do for them at that moment except just be there. And, you know, to realize that I had, you know, gone through their wrath. I don't even know at that time of their wrath. I didn't even know why I was being singled out for anything. But, you know, they're like, you know, our way is great. Like they were captives of their own destinies, and they were captains of their own ships, and they had made the world their oyster, and they're going for the pearls, and why doesn't everyone do this kind of thing? And anyone who disagrees, well, with the you could just die. We're right, you're wrong. That kind of thing. And then to see them all as deer in the headlights later on, so it had all gone to crap, it had all failed, and they were filled with regret. And you knew they needed to confess to somebody. You knew they wanted to lay it down, but they just couldn't. And, pride kind of prevents that, But I just want you to know I've seen that up close. And I told you I've seen a lot of that. A lot of that from my father's generation. They're passing now, as he passed when he was only 69, young. But he had diseases and he had problems, health problems. But it just goes to show you that, money was their God. They all felt that those kind of days would never happen to them. Those kind of sorrows would never happen to them. Those kind of results would never happen. Their kids don't talk to them. Their spouse dies. They're on their own, try to eke it by in a very scaled down situation. Or they go to these funerals of their friends to see if they could maybe borrow some money. It's just so sad. Well, they're old. They have no employment options. The dream failed them. The American dream failed them. They're conforming to the world system to get the goodies of the world. The heist that, I think this is what Kelly and I are doing. I think the heist means, you join the other side, you go for all the gusto, and then look what happened. They got all the gusto. They got the privilege. They got the status. They got the money, and it all ran out. I think the Lord let it run out for them to save their souls, to have the, because they will cry out to the Lord, at long last. And I've seen that too, many times. Those deathbed confessions, the deathbed conversions, there's many of those. But I wish just once some of these old men would say to the younger generation, son, don't go the way I went, because it's going to wind up. My grandfather did say that to me. He was very supportive of me, the only one. No, he wanted me to stay the course, and I'm like, and I didn't realize how dangerous that course was, but the course is to stick it out with the Lord. I've always been, always been the kind of person that has, just really want to talk about God, want to talk about, just my focus has been on spiritual things. And the world has always troubled and vexed me. When my friend up the street said, well, you always seem like a troubled soul, yes, I was vexed by the world situation, but my goal, my joy was awaiting me. It's always just been total dedication it has to be, to our side of things. I mean, there's nothing in the world that can bring me comfort now, only disappointment, because I understand the motives of people. And they become your friend if they think they can gain something from you. Or it's not just based on, loving a person or having an affinity with them. And I want to talk about the first two commandments of God. God's main thing is to love God and then, of course, love each other. And Jesus made it clear that means loving your enemies. And when they do all these things to you, rejoice, because it means that you're in good stead with the Lord, because no servant is above his master. Now, please understand these things, these very basic principles. When we complain endlessly that, yep, they're setting us up and they're betraying us and they're lying and bearing false witness and ruining our lives. Speak up about it, of course. Take it to the Lord, yes. But then it's like if you're bummed out, then the Lord is saying to you, you're doing it wrong. You're to rejoice when those kind of things happen. Rejoicing doesn't have to be jumping up and down. It just has to be, your day is not ruined and you're going to calmly go through it because your God is the Lord. with God, all things are possible. So what do you, you know, if God is for us, who could be against us? So what do you have to, you're in good shape. What are you talking about? No, I'm bummed out. Well, you see, this is the problem with our people in America. You know, I believe the faith is being strengthened, especially where there are these beheadings and persecution by ISIS and just killing a person just because they believe in Jesus. I mean, that is, and the blood is on our hands as Americans doing that. That is sickness. But then what do you expect from you know, after killing 60 million babies? You know, and laughing about it. I mean, you don't even know depravity yet. And then making laws to say that you can kill these, and then putting a restraining order on when tapes come out about harvesting these babies as they're alive, you know, trying to prove that their things are being they're still somewhat alive or partially birthed, and they're harvesting organs and such to keep them fresh. So therefore, they're actually doing murder, you know, would be technical. To me, it's murder when you have a baby in the womb. Obviously, that baby can feel, can think, and you know, can you know, it has functions in every way, you know. So you're killing a living baby. You know, this is my outrage yesterday, but I have to again take this because their policies are so psychopathic, so anti-human, so psychotic and insane that I can't really deal with the subject matter very well because I don't understand a country that would have allowed that to happen in the first place. I don't understand how someone could put a, you know, a restraining order on coming out with the real truth about this so that people can repent and understand that's not the way to go. We don't kill children here. But in the satanic way of things, children are killed all the time. And living children through human sacrifice and things. So, you know, it looks to me like they just try to move the laws to make all this legal, and then, you know, they want to get rid of all anyone on earth who possibly, you know, disagrees. But I'm here to tell you that the Lord God has other plans. And he's going to stave them off. You notice. A long time ago, I was so vexed and grieved by the chemtrails here. I'm just so upset because I could never see the sky. And there are films that were done here back then, you know, and the films were even showing. It was like New Mexico is a beautiful place to film. Look at these awful looking films that were filmed here during that period, you know, 2002, 3, 4, 5, here, right around that period. It was really bad. The Lord told me to give it to him. And then he's shown me how he was inconsistent with them. Or how they became inconsistent in their policy. They'd fly a lot and have a lot of, then they'd be gone for a while. Then it would, you know, then the thing they didn't want, it would rain. And then, I mean, I know they've been focusing on California with their weather modification and trying to make that the drought of the century and kind of leaving but the policy was New Mexico was a big part of that. And, you know, it all fell into a battle plan of, you know, moving people off the land and getting rid of them so that the Aslan people or whatever the agreement is for the North American Union could come in and take over and repatriate these lands to the Hispanics that lost them or whatever, you know, the Mexicans that lost. I can't see this is stuff of this world. My home is not here. It's not of this world. I'm here to do as good a job as I can to be a good steward of the things God has trusted me with. You know, but I realize that it's, you know, can't take things with you know, and I just have to ask the Lord for everything. And the Lord's not against fun and you know, doing things, and he's not against, you know, it's not like everything is a pure pain and torture situation that you must flog yourself and reduce yourself to that of a wanderer on the street and basically starve to death and kill yourself to prove your loyalty to the Lord. That's programming. Lord has his people in all different stations of life. And you know, a lot of people, when they appreciate what they have and who they're around and their time in history, when they have appreciation of this moment right now, for example, the Lord loves this because you acknowledge him and say, "Thank you, Father. I am truly blessed, and it couldn't be with that. You're the only one that's really brought out all the good things. As it says in Psalm 16, all good things, anything good in my life has come from the Lord. And there's just, you won't hear me say anything else about it. I mean, there really isn't anything else to say. I mean, that's my focus. And yes, the world is very sad, but the world is not my ultimate home, and it's not permanent. So I can't let it bum me. It certainly vexes me, but the Lord has the power to guide me through it. And it's no good if I'm bummed out every day because the thing is going to hell, and because there's such uncertainty that you don't know if tomorrow all hell breaks loose, or we're going to last longer, or you just everyone seems to be living by a thread and living on the edge. So to me, it's like the best of times in terms of, I would say that the Lord made it so that my life became some kind of, a successful on many fronts, that where people were just in the beginning so mean, and now they're not mean like that. But I know you're getting a lot of that treatment, and maybe when you get older, they just sort of back off. I don't know why in this country they would be so intolerant of people's spiritual or religious pursuits, because it should have been for religious freedom here in America, if you're free to pursue Jesus Christ. But they don't. That's not the policy they have. People that pursue Jesus for real are persona non grata in this country. If you do it in the church system, that's fine because you're sequestered. But if you're really for real, that they have a really a terrible attitude toward you because they're on the other side. And that's I was going to talk about this as well, and then I think we close. I hope you understood your Romans 13, that whole rhema thing that came through the last couple of days, because it's going to be crucial to your survival. I can't emphasize that enough. If you go mano a mano with this stuff, you're going to go nuts. And you're going to fail. And you're just not here to fail. You belong to God. You're here to go with the Lord. You're not here to fail. The only way you fail is if you take your eyes off the Lord. That's how you fail. Oh, you have a little faith, remember? Okay. So please understand that before you start screaming and yelling about the awful people in the government or the, well, yes, they've always been like that. No one said they weren't like that, and no one said they were perfect. The misunderstanding of Romans 13 is because somebody edited that. Okay, so, but God intends it now for good and uses it for good to break out this rhema of the key to Romans 13 is 2 Peter 2 9. And once you put that in context, and Jude, which is only one chapter, Jude, and then compare that to the dealing of the golden calf. Once you put that together, then you have your understanding, and there's no problem with the Bible. We are not here to fight the government or to make it a better, more accountable government. If that happens because godly people are praying and there's some kind of a revival in the nation where people are turning to the Lord and then getting in positions of governmental authority. That's great. That would be, wonderful. Because what you see today is the way it looks to me is it's just like a really bad comedy, It's everything that they do, we already know what the motives are with the hidden agenda. We understand all of it. We don't need the news to propagandize it. We already saw. It's just like the cognitive dissonance about 9/11. It's a ridiculous thing. It's like, well, what's the proof of 9/11? 9/11 itself, just the mainstream footage of 9/11 was enough for me. I called it on day one. I know, it not at first while it was happening, but within a, say a week, it just it I didn't need more research. I didn't need anything. It was like, oh, okay. Wow. They pulled off their Pearl Harbor event. I mean, it's really simple. I don't have a conspiratorial view of history either. No? But when you make it so obvious, it's like there's a pizza on the table. And I say there's a pizza on the table, and they go, "Well, you're wearing a tinfoil hat, and you're evil." I went, "Well, because there's a pizza on the..." Oh, I see. The news media knows all about it, but then they have a propaganda. I get it. Okay, fine. Well, of course we expect to see that in a the most powerful nation on earth, and wouldn't the most powerful nation on earth go corrupt? Of course it would, because their God is, the God of this nation is not the Lord. Just like they've set the Constitution aside a long time ago and don't go by it, or the rule of law, or all the things that people think are still in place have been gone a long time. I think people are starting to wake up to that, and they're going, "Oh, you know what? SHI, you know, oh, it's that they're having that moment." All right, let that be the come to Jesus moment, and let the Lord lead on this. The problem we have in America is a spiritual problem. It is 100% spiritual. It's, when you have corruption and all that, it's a spiritual problem. It can only be dealt with in the spirit. And I ask the Lord right now to have mercy on this country and have mercy on these leaders. And Lord, if there's any way, steer them into righteousness, righteous acts, despite themselves, Lord, because I know you do that. And I'm asking you to do it again in Jesus' name right now. Truth be told, he's been doing this the whole time. I've reported on some of it, but it's gone in one ear out there and out the other. You guys have not received a lot of the words, a lot of the things that have happened. You keep looking for these news articles, or I don't know what you do. You're not listening. You have to at least receive the fact that the Lord has intervened on your behalf and be grateful. You have to understand the only hope you have in this situation. People think, well, the good people in the military are going to rise up and, arrest all the bad people. No, they're not. No one's coming to your rescue. You have nothing but the Lord at your, that's the only thing you've got. Your little guns and pea shooters and whatever else are a joke compared to what they have. You've only got one thing, and that's your prayer and your freedom. And if you lose that, meaning you give in, then of course, God help you. If you've given your soul away, there's really no point for you to live. In fact, you don't live. And when they say the Grateful Dead, they sold out to the devil. That's all that means. And being dead means you're not alive. And being dead means you have to feed off, like the vampire movies are about feeding off the souls of others who are intact, eventually aiming to kill the host itself, in the great death cult of the world, the force of death. I pray the Lord turn down this force of death and minimize and weaken it right now in Jesus' name. I will continue to take it to the Lord because I realize that that power there is greater than 10,000 armies, 10,000 American armies. That prayer right there is more powerful than all of them put together. And until you start to realize that, and we all do, things are going to get worse and worse until you do. And when you do, they will start to get better. Yes, the Lord's putting a burden on you at this point and putting and somewhat of the blame. I accept my part in it. Why don't you join me? I don't. Why be prideful before the Lord? What's the point? I'm some. I didn't done anything. Yes, we did. We brought the railing accusations against the government, people, and whatever celebrities and various things. People that are, the dignities, which means the glorious ones, which actually means it actually is a reference to the angels, but it's applied to people in lofty positions that are in charge, and we're subject to that. And so because of that, we have to give reverence to that and tribute to that. Tribute meaning respect to the office of the president, to the Congress, to the to the judiciary, to you know, to the Constitution, to everything you can find, to find any kind of reference. Right now, it's just well, we hate it. It's all awful, it's terrible. And that's your testimony? That's pretty pathetic. I've tried very hard to stay out of this stuff, but I have failed, ladies and gentlemen, and I admit it. And I'm just human, you know? And I get so mad, and like the abortion issue and the lawlessness and the overturning of the, you know, of cultural thing, and the, you know, the whole lie about ISIS and all the rest of it. I just get, you know, so, you know, it's all bad to, and demoralized. And what happens when I'm demoralized? I don't pray. I don't enjoy the things God has given me. My life is basically over in that moment. My day is shot. I have no joy, and I have no hope, and I have nothing. But I say I'm a Christian, I believe in Jesus, but I'm obviously not implementing the walk in Christ. I'm just talking about it. I'm not doing it because the devil has robbed my joy, overwhelmed me with the corruption of the world and all the horrible things, like showing me that I'm just gonna live in a little hovel and in a little room, feebly praying to a God that doesn't hear me while they tear it up. Or maybe my prayer will be answered, maybe it won't. Well, no, you have to understand, I don't see it that way. My prayer is answered every time without fail, or I wouldn't do it. And that's the faith the Lord's given me. And through that faith, I'm able to overcome and find my way through a lot of this stuff. But you got to realize I'm surrounded on the internet with the alternative media and the alternative news shows and the alternative this and alternative that. Everybody's so negative, I can't believe it. People that have you know, a loaf of bread, crying that they're starving, and with a loaf of bread under their arm. I can't, that is just, they're giving me, and they're trying to give the world a false sense of reality, and they're being allowed to do it because the powers that be want you to be afraid, want you to be bummed out. Because when you're bummed out, you're easier to what? Control. They do not want happiness. They don't want people being successful. And the only way you're going to overcome that, and they know that if you got out there with a positive attitude, you might become successful. So they got to make sure you never get a positive attitude. But they can't stop you from going out and doing whatever it is you got to do. They can't do that. Look, in the sight of God, some people here have set their throne above God and above humanity and above laws and above common sense. And they will be torn down in God's time. They will actually collapse of their own volition because they are so stupid in their pursuit of immortality without God. It's just so ridiculous as to be laughable. It's so pathetic as to be, you know, again, you want to take the hook and bring it out, not to end the show, but to save them from the shame of how embarrassing it would be to be them in the sight of God. So the Lord knows this. And Psalm 2, you know, the Lord laughs at them and wants you to have a good laugh too. Just don't cut the Lord out. That's the meaning of these verses. It's very similar in the caste system in the Bhagavad Gita. There's a parallel to Romans 13 in the Bhagavad Gita because the Bhagavad Gita, at the end of the day, it upholds the caste system. Yes? The Bhagavad Gita is basically justifies war. You don't know the Bhagavad Gita. There's three books you should read from the Mahabharata or the Hindu scriptures and Hindu holy books. One is the Mahabharata is too long, but you could read the Bhagavad Gita and really try to understand what that story is about. And you see the same thing, you know, the head, they talk about the head, the shoulders, the hands, you know, of the body. The body is sacred. So that from God comes the hands, you know, the warrior class, the Brahmin class of the priestly class is the head. You know, there's the merchant class. Finally, there's the servant class, and there's the Shudra class, which are under the feet, which is basically the untouchables. But the Bhagavad Gita that reinforces that this entire caste system comes from God because the body is sacred. And in a sense, it's true what they're saying on some level, on a spiritual level. This is what I believe Paul is saying in Romans 13. It's only the beginning of the chapter. It's all about sin and lawlessness. And he's addressing a specific lawlessness of a certain group of people called the Gnostics, okay? Understand that, who felt they didn't have to follow any laws at all of anybody. Because, right, they had Jesus, they were under grace, which gave them a license to sin, you know. So there was that kind of, you know, creeping in everywhere. And the other thing he's saying is basically the body of what we have here, the governments, the you know, and yeah, when our system works right, you know, there's criminals are prosecuted and they're put, you know, in jail and whatnot. When it works wrong, innocent people like the drug addicted people are thrown in jail with hardened criminals, which obviously is terrible. But again, can you fix it any other way than prayer? So he's saying that, you know, the structure of what we have here, you know, God's got it. God's hand is on God. God is allowed it and helped to create it and regulates it. But it's being regulated in such a way that justice is meted out as well. Meaning if we go godless in our society or play a game with God, you know, pretending we have Jesus when we don't, the Lord rebukes us through the various apparati that he upholds. A government by the people, for the people, is what we had had, at least shades of it from time to time. And God let these other people creep in because maybe we got decadent. Maybe we got arrogant. You know, maybe we had to be taken down a few pegs, and we certainly have been now. But still, you know, we're to be blameless. And we follow the laws. And we, you know, and so a lot of the conspiracy theory stuff, when it's conjecture, going to the character of a person to assassinate that character. And we've all done that. I would say repentance is in order. You know, you could take it to the Lord and say, well, I've heard these awful things, I don't know. But Lord, I just put this in your hands because I know it's now that I have, something will be done. See, because I have the faith to say that. If I take it to the Lord, something will be done, not nothing. When I take something to my father and ask for bread, he does not give me a stone. Never has, and he never will. No, I get results. And then, you know, when he shows me the results, sometimes they look very subtle. I'll mention them, like the inconsistency with the so-called chemtrail people. Who do you think's meddling with that? That's right. I don't have too much more to say about that, but the inconsistency is why the programs haven't worked. And now they're so vexed because the Lord has cooled the planet off, you know, and it gets cooler. It's in a cooling trend. And he brings stuff like that to confound their plans of the global warming. And then they never seem to get on track with it. They just go, it's settled science, as Obama lies through his teeth, which is the only time he ever says anything. Is the reason he lies like he does is because he has no respect for the people he's talking to. He feels they're like spoiled children. They need to be spanked and punished and corrected. And so that's why he does what he does. He's there because that's what we deserve. He doesn't have any leadership skills. That's a fact that's on the ground. That's not having a railing accusation. He is not a leader. That is true. And so in that department, he is incompetent. And with incompetent leadership, you have a world like we have today, especially when the most powerful country in the world is behaving the way it's behaving and failing at everything it does, which some of that's by design. You know, eventually that may get your attention. I certainly would hope that the organized religion churches who claim Jesus are no different than the ones in China, I would hope that they would wake up. but don't count on it. You know, certain, I was going to pray about something today, and the Lord led me away from it and said, no. I can't remember what it was. It was a person. No, do not pray for this one. Anyway, I want to remind you all about one more time about prayers for Brother Thomas and his, I guess, migraine condition. He wrote about it in his blog, if you know how to get to that. And then I got a note from a friend who blogs him all the time, Roger. He sometimes blogs us as well. And he's got a lot of videos. He did a video about it asking for prayer. And then somebody else shared this yesterday is when I saw it. And I went and I saw the blog. And so I realized that, you know, I realize he's under attack. And he has been, I think, you know, probably because he's had a lot of similar messages, too, about, you know, being grateful for what you have. And, you know, this is the real spiritual warfare, you know, succeeding in this environment, because you succeed when you're joyous. When you're bummed out, you fail. And you're not a good testimony unto the Lord. You're a bad testimony. And you're not a good example for others. And you're not a light in a dark place. You understand? See, you got to set aside all this, you know, and I need to tell everybody this. See, set aside all this negative news and you know, put on some classical music. And then, you know, that's what I did for dinner last night. I put on Beethoven. I can't remember what it was. It was just I have a channel that I've created on Pandora for Beethoven. So I put that on and it was like, now isn't that a nice breath of fresh air? Isn't that joyous, those little tweety birds in there? I love it. Isn't that a nice recording? I love that. Am I escaping? No, I think I'm appreciating the fact that I'm having a meal and had a very nice meal last night. And, you know, I had finished, you know, the mix on Kelly's record. I just put it, Kelly's record. It's really what it is. And it's really was, it ended up being, you know, her track. It's really her thing produced by me. That's really what it is. And I'm just, you know, I was going to release it last night, and then I kind of went to bed, and I'm sitting here now, and it's gotten on in time, and I'm like, gosh, you know, I just want to make sure the T's are crossed and I's. And I did a little video, and I want to make sure the video doesn't take away. So I started listening to the song without the video. I'm like, this is 10 times better. When I show the video, it kind of gets in the way of the song. And then I realize that maybe because I'm just too familiar with it. I don't know. I do a little video because I like to, you know, entertain you with images, but ultimately it doesn't need video. It's just that's a cool, it's fun. You know, I took one of them down, or I edited some of my video and took some things down that were up there, some personal things. My Zeph Daniel video thing is probably just going to have music on it. I haven't decided whether I'm going to take another pseudonym for the music and, you know, just use that as a name or a handle, you know, create a handle like how, you know, Rich Keltner is Keltron. And I'm, you know, I had Zed Job, but I could also just as easily be another name no one ever heard of as a pseudonym, so that when people search, they, you know, either get music or they get, you know, they get one or the other. I haven't decided. I've been confused on the whole thing for a long time. So I just stick with Zeph Daniel because that's the name the Lord gave me. And so that's the one I keep. All right. Sort of like the Lord put me in New Mexico. So I stay there. No, I don't tend to question there's some stuff I'm very obedient on. You know, I'm not rebellious toward the Lord. That I mean, I am naturally, my flesh is, but in general, I'm not rebellious toward God. I think that's pretty obvious to people. And I think, you know, because I know that all good things come from Him. So to recap, the Romans 13 is basically, you know, the upshot of it, sort of prophetically, deeply looking into the scripture, is basically don't cut God out of the equation when dealing with the government, because the Lord has got His hand on it. He knows how to keep the righteous. I'll go to Peter 2:9 after that. He knows how to keep the righteous free from temptation and guide them, just as he holds the wicked to account for judgment, wherever they may be. Therefore, we don't need to bring railing accusations, because even the archangel Michael didn't do that. He said, the Lord rebuke thee. So when I put it all together, what does it show you? And that we cut the Lord out, and we bandy about, and we talk about, and I've done it. I had a song called Mr. Politically Correct, and well, I have the right to do songs like that, because see, I believe it's hypocritical to do every song be a quote in the style of worship music, which I hate, because I feel that's hypocritical. Now, all music needs to be, all music to me is sacred in a sense. It's so when we do something like Mr. Politically Correct, we do things that you say, well, where's God in that? Well, these observations are, in my view, exposing something that needs to be exposed, that the political correctness is a real, bad thing in our society. And so I think it does a service. But I mean, I don't question where the music goes. It goes where it goes. I show up to do it. And I see that the Lord's got to have his hand on it, because a lot of stuff that I'm going to do, it doesn't happen. Stuff I stumble into, like this track with Kelly, I've just stumbled into it and turned out to be really great on her part. I mean, she really, it was just right for her, which shows me that she has a real talent in a kind of rock, blues, jazz, R&B area, which is just a natural thing. I've started discovering this recently about her. She just, it's almost like she was somebody else in another life, because where did this come from? A lot of us have things like that, but it's really strange. I can see her in another life being this, a black singer, because she's, and it's where, if you hear it, you'll hear, I don't know, maybe it'll be out before you hear this podcast. I don't know, because I'm going to, I'll just stick the tune on the back end of this. So when this is over, it will play. No, I won't do that because it's not high enough fidelity. I'm sorry. I'll put something else like, I'm still here, false prophet. I just love putting that on the end of everything. And I need to come up with intros and outros. I actually do. But I think, are we clear about, what is your calling in life? What is your thing here? And it's got to be the Lord, doesn't it? Your country, your world, your kingdom is not of this world. Now you know that. You're here as an ambassador of God himself. And not to get all caught up in the affairs of the world. And, establishing the just nation on earth, you're not going to do that. Now that's not your calling. That is not your business. We do the best we can given this environment, but again, bringing railing accusations. I have to tell you something. I have no hatred for any government official. And the reason I don't hate them, and I may not like what they do. I may hate things they do, the abortion being one of them. But in terms of my feeling about them, I just feel like there, but for the grace of God, go on, that we are all in the same boat. Now, I'm outreaching to people right now. And I'm praying for people, unless the Lord stops me, which he did today, and I can't even remember who it was. I think he took that memory away of who it was. I think he wiped that part of the computer out, so that I wouldn't then bring a railing accusation against them and call them irredeemable. Being stopped from praying for someone doesn't mean forever. It just means not now. Hope you understand that. I hope you understand a lot of things. I realized yesterday, this is not, I'm really not trying to be arrogant or anything like that, but I realized that somehow it had, the word of the Lord had come down to me to speak it. It had been given to me to speak. I said, but Lord, they don't hear when your word is when the Rhema comes, they don't really hear it, but it's come to me to do it. I'm in this position. That's what the Lord is doing with me. He's putting me sort of in the driver's seat of the word for now. I don't know why that is. Maybe I've been there, I'm just realizing it. But I mean, in all of this country anyway, in the world, I'm one of the very few people in this position. You know, if maybe I don't say the only one, but I don't know. It's just that it's like, yeah, okay. So what do I do, Father? You know, just continue on. They say, well, I know these preachers, these other people have all this impact, and they have these great sermons, and it's like, yeah, the Lord is raising up the foolish thing to confound the wise. You know that, right? You know that very well. And so you have this little voice over here. And so what is my answer? What is the change in me? What's happening? Well, the love of God is coming through to you. And the rhema and the mystery being broken out and understood. And then the prayers working and healing and moving so powerfully. And so I want to be, I'm kind of cheering that on. Most of the people that are dealing with God and everything through this, they're all looking at prophecy, the next false flag attack, the horror, all things to come. And they're blending it then with the scriptures and things. It doesn't blend. You got to go with whatever God's giving you. And I'm very, very, I have that ability to be very loose. You know, that like even like playing music with jamming with people, I can be very, very fluid, you know? And I mean, I can change on a dime. Whatever the Lord's good, I'll go there. Okay, Lord, I'll go there. Right? Rather than sticking to some rigid preconception. So I guess it's just a talent, you know? Whatever. I'm using the talent. I'm not burying it in the backyard. So it's coming forth, you know, tenfold, a hundredfold, a thousandfold, a millionfold, whatever, incalculable. Those who receive this word today, you know, you're taking baby steps. And then pretty soon there'll be full strides, you know, in your confidence, which when people see it will marvel. They'll realize that it has to come from God, because where are you going to get confidence like that around here? Most people here that say they believe in Jesus are demoralized. They're totally demoralized. They're devastated. They're completely bummed out. They're questioning whether God is just and good anymore. They're looking for answers outside the scriptures, which is fine. There are lots of answers out there. You've got the Book of Enoch, you've got the news, you've got the phone book, you've got the phone book's very true. It's very much the Word of God. You look anyone up in there, you call up the number that's in the phone book. You know what I mean? And they pick up the phone. It's very true. Think about that. The veracity of the phone book is just quite stunning. It's probably the most true document we produce. Yep. I see, too, there's people out there that want to produce fiction. Well, my God, man, what are you waiting for? Well, don't you think it has to be a godly topic? Hey, look, I used to write horror movies and stuff. I've got a horror idea now. I don't think it matters. I just, you know, be led to do whatever you're going to do. I'm not writing anything now. I have a horror idea, but the world has become so horrific. I don't really, you know, it's like, but I you know, an idea. But yes, I used to write those things, and I'd write as a script doctor as well. A lot of things that have been produced. In various genres and, you know, horror and, you know, and I found great value in horror. Well, and sci-fi horror too, like Invasion of the Body Snatchers. I found great truth in that. The vampire, the original vampire series was really a metaphor of those who had sold out to the death cult, who'd become immortal, but they'd have to suck the blood of innocents. Doesn't that resonate, folks? Good horror always is a metaphor, and good sci-fi too, and you know, good graphic novels. I tend to like that area. I'm not really a horror guy. I'm really more sci-fi. I love good, not when it becomes preachy. You know, like I think this I don't have a lot of hope for the people that like the Hunger Games liking that. But anyway, I'm not gonna waste the time. I've got to get in the studio and mix. It's either that or let me check where we are now. Okay. I'm going to have to get in there, and there's another thing that I've started that I need to finish. It's called Travel Memories, and I know that it just sounded like noise to you, and that's just the first step. And that was produced on a laptop. It wasn't even done in the studio. But I'm very much about sound, and I don't know where this is going, but I have to continue. I think it's taken me to the Middle East, where I don't think God has forgotten about the desert. God is moving all over the planet, but God has not forgotten about the desert. You see, things happen in the desert that could never happen in the city, never happen in the mountain, and never happen out at sea. Things happen, revelations, people pop out of nowhere. It's the most bizarre thing, deserts, and how God deals with people in the desert. Desert's a very strong metaphor in the Bible as well. Desert is something. God's not done with the Middle East. He's not done with Jerusalem. He's not done with the Jews, the Catholics, the Protestants, the evangelicals, the Baptists, or the various groups. He's not done at all. You know, he's well, one of the worst things that happened to people besides Roe v. Wade was this in the 60s, this 501c3 business of having a charitable deduction you can write off. But in exchange for that, the church had to put a gag on their face, which God would never allow. You know, God cannot bless that. So until they learn, I mean, I don't know what it's going to take for them to learn that they have to divorce themselves from the 501c3 in order to, and repent. And they've been, I don't know how many people, voices of God, how many people have come along who have from God, you know, told them, the Lord rebuke you and the Lord tells you to repent. The Lord will not share the stage with any country or state. So wake up, you know, and I tell you, people that are in your church situations, all your prayers are pretty much in vain. None have come true, and none of your prophecies have come true. So don't you take that as a sign? It's since it's no one believes in it anymore anyway, they just get together for the social aspect, the donuts and the coffee. Aren't you tired of that? Or you read the Bible and you study it, but then you pray about something and nothing happens. Or very little, you know, sometimes something happens to keep you on the to keep you going, because in Jesus' name will not return in vain completely, but don't you realize that if you took that thing off, you would be blessed beyond belief? People should not take a deduction anyway. If they want to give a gift to, this should be outlawed in this country. If people want to give a gift to the church, it should be they give a gift and they don't take it off their taxes. And that's a ridiculous thing, and it's a bad bargain. And maybe it was innocent going into it, but look at the damage it's done. Repent of it already. Get rid of it. If you're not registered as a 501c3 and you're unregistered, you're just a church, a fellowship that's going forward that doesn't have ties, and you know who you are out there. Some of you have fairly large ones that are not connected to this system, and God bless you, you know, pray for your protection. I'm sure you are making a big difference. But if the church wants to make a difference in this country, I think the country itself is proof of the church's failure. Yes, okay, so it's pretty obvious. Since the majority of people here are still Christian and in a Judeo-Christian tradition, but they have lost their, they've been propagandized out of praying, God's uncool, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. God hates gays, blah, blah, blah. There's been this horrible, and you know what replaces all that? Once you throw all that out, you get hell. All right? You get, you know, all the laws change to conform to nothing but do what you want under the color of law, whatever kind of sex, whatever kind of abortion, whatever kind of war, whatever kind of just riots. Interesting how the Bible talked about they bring riots in 2 Peter. They bring these, they riot. I may be mistaken. I read riots today. I don't know. I thought it was 2 Peter, but yeah, they riot. They feel justified in rioting tearing up, lawlessly destroying businesses and people, rioting because they have a grievance from the past that can only be resolved in a mano-a-mano situation. No, the grievance they have from the past is a spiritual, only can be resolved in prayer with God, and because it goes to forgiveness. And the thing is that if I wanted to hold a grudge against Satanists for persecuting me, lying to me, traumatizing me, and making my life completely horrible, I could start suing them right and left where I find them. But of course, that's absurd. I have to let it go, and I must forgive, and I must walk on. If that's impending on my life, some kind of bitterness about that, or some kind of it's gonna stop me from living. It's gonna ruin my life. It's not gonna do anything to the people that were the perpetrators. These people that are perpetrators of those kinds of things, gang stalking is part of it, all that, just trying to get out ahead of you and throw all kinds of roadblocks in front of you, just make sure your life is miserable. And, drive you hopefully to suicide, then laugh at your death. Yes, there are people like that in this country, unfortunately. But the solution, well, no, that stuff doesn't really happen anymore, but it's there's always a, my frustration is even about stuff like that. It's, I just let that stuff go at this point. If I see it coalescing out there, I just say, yeah, bring it on. I don't give a damn. I've been around this thing so many times that it's so boring. And so I just ignore I'm not saying it doesn't happen. I just ignore it. Right, where people start saying things only. It's because, look, the people doing the process. I told you that the reason the gang stalking thing has changed is because it is demonic and it's gone mainstream now. So it's a political tool that is basically global. It was, the whole world's targeted at this point. I think and that's going to take the focus off you and make your life easier. And then you realize, oh, not just I see now. Yeah, well, it's demonic as well. You know how you're in a place and you're walking by, let's say a supermarket, because there's aisles and items, and then they say something that only they could know, that only you know, and no one could really know about you in conversation right next to you. Okay, let me explain what's happening so you stop freaking out. The demons know everything about you. And this is, you should have learned this in church, but you didn't. The demons, this is Demonology 101. The demons know everything there is to know about you. Where you went to school, who your friends were, everything. What were your good points, what things you're ashamed of, and know things that you've never told anybody. And they are possessing these people that are, right? Those people are not on their own being orchestrated, they're possessed. And so they're saying things they don't even know. They know they're possessed. They know they're being used to say things that they have no clue about. But the deal they've made is they've allowed themselves to be used in that way. So they can't fight it, and they say things. It's like they're gone for a minute, and the demon takes over and says something through them that only you would know, and no one else could possibly know. And then, okay, the next thing that happens is the fear chord is struck in you, big time. It becomes fight or flight, panic attackville. You're freaked out, and you got to get out of there. Am I beginning to make some sense? Am I right here? Of course I am. Now, I've been dealing with this thing for, 40, 50 years, whatever, I catch it, all this stuff. Most people don't. If you had just understood this and rebuked the demon, the Lord rebuke you as well. You rebuke that demon in Jesus' name, or the Lord rebuke you. Same difference. You don't do it alone. You don't go, I rebuke you. And then you continue on your day unfettered. How would that be? Your day not unhinged, but your day very much a placid, fun day. You're continuing on. You go get your items at the market. You go out and have a picnic, whatever you're going to do. But you know, yes, it's evil and it's horrible, and I feel sorry for those people that are perpetrating it. But they can't do anything to you. If your fear cord isn't hit, then that's it. They shot all their ammo and they missed. You just walk right through the demons. The Lord makes a place for you in this world. You have every right to go anywhere you want. You don't go, it's better for them to go running home. And they will, if you just simply smile at them and go, you know, I mean, this is what you might want to try. The next time they do that, you just walk by and go, nice try. And then it put them out of your mind and keep on going with whatever your day is. You know, and then if you see them running to the parking lot and jumping in their car, and if they know you can, remember I brought up the story about this woman in the music forum, and she had this very hypnotizing kind of like a video to go with a music, but basically it was these Jezzy's getting control of this guy and then wanting him to, you know, perform sexually for them, you know, give them a show, so to speak. I don't need to go more into it than that, do I? And then, so it was like, you know, it was weird though. You know what I mean? There was like a weird thing on it. I said very innocently to her, I said, you know, what is this about? You know, what exactly, you know, like I was confused by, I didn't, because it wasn't just about sex exactly, you know, and or them watching him getting himself off or whatever. It was, you know, what is this about? You know, why are you, you know, and she flipped out. She went completely insane. And she took the thing down immediately. You know, there's all these comments of all these guys were chiming in going, hey, when's my turn? You know, wanting to get involved, right, couldn't wait. And then there was me. What is this exactly? Because I was seeing something else. I was seeing beyond that surface of it. And so she confirmed it by running away. She'd been there for months, had been doing videos, had people just thought she was the greatest musician and gave her all kinds of feedback. There was already, you know, 15 comments on it when I made my comment. But my comment brought the entire house down and brought her down to nothing. You know, so, and why? Because she was depicting the satanic slavery ritual that goes on and, you know, figuring no one's going to figure that out. All I asked was a question. I didn't say anything proactively. I didn't need to. It's obviously demonic, and it was obviously there to hypnotize the people there, especially the men, into a certain thing. And, you know, I just asked what it was, you know, because I'm kind of, stuff like that doesn't work on me, right? So, does it work on you? Stuff, I'm not hypnotizable, you know, I never have been. So, anything like that doesn't work on me. Anyway, she went running away, disappeared, lost her account, you know, never saw her again. She was a prominent person in film in New York. So she was actually a prominent individual. This is somebody that works with celebrities and, you know, big movies and all that. And I had no idea. After that, I left the thing, you know, eventually, because I was too tired of, you know, all the people that were pagans, and they were all into the, you know, not just into stuff like that, which is slavery, by the way. You know, when Jezebel owns your testicles, you know, and your will is not your own, you have to go to them to ask permission if you want to do something in the world. Excusez-moi, but that is slavery. The same thing, if you pass by these people in the you know, if you display, like, you know what's happening, and you walk by and you just go, nice try, it doesn't work today, you know? You know, carry on if you feel you must. I'm off with my day. I'm enjoying myself. That would also send them, the same exact result would happen, because you're indicating something that you know exactly what they're up to. And that blows their mind and puts them in a fear moment and strikes their fear chord. And they run because they don't have Jesus. They don't have the Lord backing them up. If they get busted, you know, being too revelatory, you know, if it's so easy to discern what they're talking about, they get in trouble. You know, they get pounded, sometimes killed. So that's why they're so afraid, because they're worried that, you know, something's going to come out of nowhere and clock them. And it does. They are forbidden totally to divulge secrets, one of which is that there is a world like that, you know? So they figure they could put a little video together of this scene, figuring that most people wouldn't know what they were looking at. And then I came along and ruined, of course, the whole thread, the whole day, all the comments, everything. I ruined it. It blew up. But I earnestly wanted her to explain what she was doing. She couldn't. She felt busted. She wasn't worried about me. She was worried about the retribution from her horrible master. And, you know, who, you know, any range of torture will do. I'm sure she got punished. Because you're not supposed to put that stuff in film. And in that stuff doesn't exist. And I know there's no sense getting scared about all this. This is, unfortunately, the spiritual battle that we find ourselves in. I don't... they think they're so clever, having this other world that, you know, no one will detect, that they arrogantly sometimes put it out there. And, you know, they have, oh, we've gone through lyrics here. We've gone through the Zeph report. We've gone through all manner of ways that they try to put it and display it out in plain sight, but so that you can't figure out what it is. If you do figure out what it is, then they could get in trouble, because there's supposed to be a veil there. And the only way that you can actually get through the veil to see what's over there is to break on through to the other side. And if you, that's the only way you're going to understand what's on that side. If you start understanding it without breaking on through the other side, then everyone's in real trouble, especially them. So Jesus would do that all the time. He would, we're talking about demonology here. What there is over there on the other side is a world run by demons. That's correct. Demonic possession is what the other side is. That's correct. Yes, they have power. So when they possess you, you have, suddenly you can write music that you could never write. You can do things you could never do. Wow, you know, the world's your oyster. You know, wow, you can make money and then you can just tear it up. The heist that Kelly and I are talking about, or that Kelly's talking about in this track I'm producing with her. Yes. Yes, the heist. You broke on through the heist. You know, and now you're filled with regret. You got everything you wanted. You got the world. You got the gold. You took the loot. Yeah, take the money and run, as the Bohemian Grover, Steve Miller, stated. You go on, take the money and run. You know. but yeah, they get freaked out when you understand. Look, here's my point. I'm not here to have a pissing contest with the devil's own and his lair and his world. We're here to help save souls, you know, from destruction. And you may think it's funny when you're young to break on through to the other side, but it simply means you're slated for destruction. You're on your way to the slaughterhouse. You're in the lineup. You don't know when it's coming, but it's going to come for you. And on that day, if you're not in possession of your soul, then your ride's punched. In my opinion, you know, taking from everything I know about the world and everything I know about it, my best guess is that you're recycled into a lot more pain and suffering. You can't die. You just can't get away from it. Those that go on with the Lord escape this matrix, escape this cube, this thing we're in, you know, this time-space continuum, this horrible thing. We go with the Lord because we're done with this. And, you know, being spin cycled 50 more thousand times, not my interest. Or maybe I'll win the game one of these days. Win the game? You mean be like Warren Buffett? In case you hadn't noticed, he's on his last legs. His billions aren't going with him. And he's, you know, the his family can haggle about it all. You know, same with the Walmart situation, and the heirs there. And then those heirs, you know, does that mean they have, you know, you have to understand something. You can't take any of this stuff. I don't care how many billions you have, or if you have millions, or if you have 1,000, or if you have 50, or if you have $10. It really doesn't matter because the day of your, when the Lord calls you home, that's it. That $10, the clothes you're wearing, nothing. It all stays here. The house you have or you think you don't have. Look, folks, at best, you know, everything belongs to the Lord. You know, you just have to live that way, asking the Lord to direct your steps. At best, you're renting. You know, you say, well, I own my house. No, you don't. You're renting that space because when you die, you don't have that space anymore. So we're renting everything we have when you think about it. We don't really own it. I go in, I look at my Pultec EQs, which are really fantastic on bass, drums, and you know, things where you need some punch. They've duplicated them, but they've come up with a version that's a lot cheaper and all that. But it's, you know, I vote for the real thing. Anyway, I've got two of them, and it's almost like having a stock. The price keeps going up in terms of the sales price because it's really. For these guys to recreate that, this was built in the 1940s using, you know, the tubes and valves and all these different things from that period. They're heavy boxes. And there just is no, there's no getting around, you know, no getting around it. I mean, there's no getting around the fact that, you know, what it takes to have the. I don't even remember. I don't even know why I brought that up. I'm going to just, you know, scratch that for now. I think the main thing is this. Oh, okay. I can't take those with me. Yeah, I look at them. They're really solid. They're going to outlive me, okay? Like, these will live on 100 years. I mean, these are just mechanical. It's a mechanical box. That, you know, and it's very solid. It looks like it did something from the, you know, from the nuclear plant in the 1960s or something. It's very solid. It's all mechanical and it's going to outlive me. And I look at that stuff and I realize, and then I look at the rest of the hardware and I have, you know, compressors and EQs and all kinds of hardware, right? Analog gear. And I realize the whole rack itself, everything will outlive me. I mean, at least you start coming into that idea when you get older. And so you start thinking about, well, how am I going to get it out? Who am I going to get it to? You know, that I want it to go to the right place, the right people. So I have to figure out, and how am I going to get it to them? And who's going to come in here and, you know, break down the racks and dismantle everything. I have to appropriate for that. I've got to make sure that when I go, well, you know what brings my mortality to, you know, into question or as an issue, I guess, or what makes me think about mortality, is that Roddy Piper, you know, the great hero of They Live, and who probably just through that one single act of being in that movie helped to open more people's eyes than I pretty much than the Bible, almost on the same level. But he was 61. We were the same age, okay? Roddy Piper died at 61 years old, and yours truly is 61 years old. So when I heard he was 61, I'm like, that's too young. I just seem to be figuring it out now. Certainly, the word of the Lord is now making sense, yes? And the feeling and the healing and the power and the glory and all of it is just coming in. And it's like, but he was 61. He could just die right now. And then I realize, you know, and when those things are built really solid, it makes me think of my own more, like those Pultecs are built like there's no way that nothing is built like those. And the price reflects it, but nothing is built like those. Those are just, it's like there's a Fairchild amplifier, you know, there's, or compressor, right? And they always talk about that. And not Fairchild, oh shoot, I can't remember now. But they don't make though. This is a guy who decided, you know, after the company went, they built these in the 1940s, okay? And then there's the company went bankrupt or whatever. And then another guy who used to work at the company of called Pulse Techniques is the company name. Pulse Techniques, he revived it and took the company name and started building the Pultex again to exact specifications of the models, I think from the 60s or whatever. And he had the only one who has the right to call it a Pultec. And they do some, you know, very interesting thing that vital for a studio because they provide punch for bass and drums and the bottom end that you just can't get. It's just one of those tools that when you need it, you know, it's nothing else will do. But anyway, that being said, I have one of the Pultecs says Pulse Techniques on it. The other one says Pultec. And it's just interesting. They're both manufactured at a different time, but this guy puts these things together by hand in his garage, or he was back when I bought these. He'll build you can't just buy them, no. You have to order them and then wait your turn. And he has to build it for you to the exact specification. He's hand wiring all of it. And so when I encounter something like that, you know, and I tap my finger against it, you know, it's just really solid. It makes me think, oh my God, what about, I'm not that solid. Well, I'll say goodbye. I just hope we know what, it may outlast the next guy too. I just don't know. But one thing's for sure, I don't really own it. I mean, I do, but I don't. And that's the way everything is here. Roddy Piper may have had a wife and a dog and a house and all kinds of things like that, a car. But his time to go is his time to go, and none of that stuff goes with him. All those people will see him again and his dog and everything. And I hope I may see my animals again. And my father and my brother and my mother, I hope, you know. I mean, everyone's gone from me. But, you know, we'll have to have another podcast episode about, mortality and immortality. And my soul, of course, it's always going to be around. I'm not worried about that. But I am worried about, you know, people that think somehow they can win the game here. There's no winning when there's the specter of death over us all. And, you know, we really have to give an account to the Lord. So it's what are the first two commandments? Okay, back to this. Love God, love each other. Okay, we're not doing that. We're not doing that. So let me, you know, we can do that. Yes, we're capable of it. Well, love the one who comes to get, just think of who your enemies are and then think love. People that have hurt you in the past, and then think forgiveness and love. Praying blessings upon them, especially that they would give themselves to the Lord, that they would see the light, that they would come into the truth. Yes, love. Because you see, the reason why that's so important is because we don't live here forever. The people we see are wearing masks. They're playing roles that they may not play when we see them again in eternity. You know, the mean Nazi guard that puts the Jews to death in one life, that mask remained. In Christ, there's a beautiful person that saves souls. I mean, you know, that's the person that he really is. And because of that shifting sand reality we have, in other words, nothing permanent here. And everything has changed ultimately anyway. And if you go with the Lord, we're changed, right? We're with the, you know, the whole sin nature of man and the fall of man is taken off in Christ. And so who would we be then? Certainly not, and not anyone that was hurt. not anyone traumatized, not anyone looking for payback. You know, you're just in a different space. Well, that space could be, you know, entered into right now. But, you know, especially on the internet where there's all this political talk and people get mad. And I understand that. But then get mad is fine. Don't let the sun go down. You feel like, okay, these abortions, these are technically hurting me. Well, you know, they're hurting themselves. The Lord already knows what they're going to do. And so he's, you know, the babies come in and he takes them, they go home, you know, on cue. But the people who would do such a thing obviously need a great healing because there's something wrong with it. If you pray for them, that will do much more than, you know, castigating them and screaming. If you scream at them, they're going to keep on doing the same thing they've been doing. Figuring they're in a war and they have to win. The only way they can win is to keep going. But if you pray for them and for the truth and for the babies and for the whole situation, and the Lord won't let us get away with that. If we don't forgive, he won't forgive. If we don't forgive, we don't enter in. And if we don't love, we atrophy, we die. Because God is love, because the whole thing is about that. And so, I mean, I know there's people with such fervency and wanting to really scare you. But quite often, it becomes like things I've said in the past, you know, where it looks like there's two different species. Well, yes, I guess so. From this perspective, yes, it looks like that. But sometimes people change. Anyway, I'm hoping I can learn some of these lessons because I would like to be able to, when people do things to, you know, to keep my joy, to keep my life going and just patiently deal with whatever obstacle there is, figuring there's always going to be obstacles. And there's some people, they're just born to put those there in front of you. They're just troublemakers in that way. And they're looking for, you know, if they can mess with you or like the bureaucratic mentality, if they can slow you down or create some red tape that you can't get beyond, you can get mad, scream at them. They're awful people. They should never have been born. They're just blights on humanity. You know, you could go through that whole litany. Or you could, you know, say, okay, you know, take it with being, that's the territory here on earth, and, you know, and just basically go through not letting it interrupt you and your joy, your love, your peace, your direction, your, you know, regardless. It's just like, yeah, it's part of the deal, and so you deal with it. You know, better if you don't even think about the person doing something awful. You know, you just go, oh, well, okay, so I'll deal. But then they say, no, at some point, Zeph, you're going to have to pick up a weapon and kill the enemy. Yes, but it must be done in love. Oh, what did he just say? Yeah, you can't have a personal animus against the enemy. If you want to be a better soldier, I mean, when they kill your best friend and you want to go out and really shoot him up, a lot of those guys end up dead. You want to be a good soldier, it's just you have to increase your kill rate. The best way to do that is dispassionately. If you're very passionate, you're going to make mistakes. You're going to jeopardize other people in the unit as well. Hotheads don't make it anywhere in life. People spewing hatred, division, setting a bad example, screaming, feeling justified in screaming and yelling, cutting God out of the equation completely. We can't do that, folks. Okay, I'm going on.
So miserable today. There's a reason why we approach the end of the age, a time when all will be revealed. remedy to your misery. There is a remedy to your misery.
Shut up. Listen.